Ocean trash is terrible for sea creatures, right?
But after encountering countless sea creatures interacting with trash, I'm not convinced. So in this video, I'm on a mission to explore the reefs most affected by ocean waste, gathering all the evidence we need to answer one burning question. Is ocean trash actually bad for marine life? But at this point, you're probably wondering what on earth I'm talking about. So let me show you.
Oh, I can see something very funny.
This bit of plastic pipe has become wedged in the sand, and it's now the home of a very resourceful fangtooth blenny. But this blenny isn't just using it as a hiding place.
Well, there's two of them in there.
And two blennies sharing the same hiding spot can only mean one thing. Eggs. Now, this is just one of many examples of marine life taking advantage of trash. However, not all trash is created equal. Some drifts with the currents, some rolls along the seafloor, and some is a bit more, well, permanent.
Well, that's a big bit of trash.
And in this video, we're exploring it all. Now, to be clear, I'm obviously not advocating for more trash in the ocean. We are all aware of the massive scale of this problem. But this video isn't really about trash. It's about the remarkable adaptability of the creatures that live in our oceans. Starting with one very intelligent ocean critter that knows how to make the most of the debris left behind on the ocean floor.
So, here we have what looks like a ceramic plant pot that's cracked in half. And there's obviously lots of smaller fish swimming around the front of it. But there's something very cool hiding underneath. So if I pick this up really carefully, you'll see we have some cuttlefish eggs. How cool are they? So what's really cool is you can see the little baby cuttlefish inside and the yolk sacs. And given these eggs are white, it's probably not long until they hatch. And when they do, they'll be fully formed cuttlefish ready to go and hunt on the reef. This is a great example of a reef creature making the most of some human trash. Right, let's set it back down gently and go and find something else.
However, one of the biggest issues with sea creatures making use of trash is that it's not always permanent. And unfortunately, some of the developing cuttlefish aren't so lucky.
There's a load of eggs on this one, look. But for some reason, it's been flipped over, so hopefully there's some live ones there and we'll flip it back over.
But it's not just the cuttlefish that make the most of these pots, because they're also great places to hide.
So here we've got another one of these pots that's turned over in the sand. And interestingly, this one seems to be the home of a little damselfish. He's pretending to be very brave though, but you watch, as soon as I get close, he'll shoot back into his hole.
These small black-banded damsels are incredibly territorial. And in areas with limited coral cover, they will claim any structure.
I've just found a few more of these damselfish, but these ones are really tiny, and they're living under this plastic plate.
And they are not picky at all, making use of all sorts of trash, from pots and plates to plastic bottles and cans. Some even manage to find hiding spots that are a little more comfy. However, what we found next is really odd.
Oh, so this is a shampoo bottle or something. Looks very fresh. Subscribe? Oh, that's strange.
Now, it's not just the damselfish that have made homes amongst the trash. Although, unfortunately, some fish are a little too round, so their options are pretty limited.
Oh, and here we've got a porcupine fish in a pan. Looks pretty cozy, doesn't it?
This small fangtooth blenny seems perfectly content drifting in the surge, attached to a frilly plastic bag. Right next to a bottom-dwelling goby that's holed up inside a discarded bottle. With a single entrance, these bottles make ideal, easy-to-defend shelters, and on a reef with limited hiding spots, they are prime real estate. Later that night, we realised just how valuable these makeshift homes can be, but more on that later. However, whilst these homes made from trash might serve a purpose in the short term, unfortunately, they are rarely permanent, and as ocean currents pick up, the small fish that make the most of ocean trash can do nothing but watch their homes float away. However, for some fish, drifting trash is exactly what they are after.
Whoa, shark sucker! So this here is another piece of human trash, and these shark suckers are trying to stick to it. These guys actually have a specialized suction cup on the top of their head, and they use it for attaching to big megafauna like sharks and turtles. And they do this to hitch a ride so they can pick off scraps of food as the bigger fish swims along. And this one looks like he's trying to attach to his butt.
But although these shark suckers like to attach themselves to things that are on the move, the majority of creatures like things that stay in one place. And on this reef, humans have introduced other trash and artificial structure that isn't going anywhere anytime soon.
So here we've got another man-made structure. This is a big concrete mooring block. And the cool things with these mooring blocks, like you can see with all these small fish, is that in this sort of sandy landscape, stuff is drawn to these. And interestingly, this block has been here for so long that we've even got some corals growing on the side. And these corals are fantastic homes for small little reef fish like these damselfish. Oh look, and there's even a little banded coral shrimp under here. For those of you that have seen my previous videos, this block and these bags might look a little bit familiar. And that's because the last time I was here, there was a massive estuarine stonefish sat underneath these bags using them for camouflage. Let's see if he's here today. Oh, there's no stonefish, but there's a massive fimbriated moray eel under here. Hopefully you got a good glimpse of him then.
But these old bags do more than just provide cover for stonefish and eels. As I zoomed in, I realized this one was covered in small critters like this nudibranch that were grazing on the fields of nutritious algae that had covered the bag. And these mollusks aren't just here to feed. These small snails are busy laying a clutch of eggs. The textured surface of these bags helps secure the eggs, and with food as far as these little snails' eyes can see, I think they've picked a pretty good spot. But it's not just concrete and stone that corals, sponges, and algae latch onto.
This here is a big truck or tractor tire. And again, structures like this are just great places for a load of creatures to hide. You can usually find all sorts of stuff in them, like moray eels, lionfish, and big groupers. And interestingly, a few months ago I found another one like this that was full of cleaner shrimps. And when I put my hand in, they gave my hands a clean.
But other crustaceans have also taken up residence around these tires. And what we found next is perhaps one of the craziest examples of marine life adaptation I have ever seen.
So here we've got what looks like some old discarded fishing line, and it's covered in these balls of algae. Oh, but look at this! There's a little decorator crab, and he's covered in algae to match the fishing line.
These decorator crabs are masters of disguise, covering themselves with rubble and debris to stay hidden. This one has perfectly camouflaged itself against this algae-covered fishing line. Unfortunately, discarded fishing gear makes up a huge percentage of ocean trash, and is also some of the most devastating, posing a serious risk of entanglement. But for this crab at least, it's become just another part of its camouflage.
So yeah, there's loads of crazy creatures on this tire, and although this is trash, it's a good example of trash that has some level of ecological benefit. And I'm sure all the creatures that live on this one aren't complaining too much. Anyway, let's go and find something else.
But other large structures cover the ocean floor here, and these ones have been put down for good reason.
So this structure here is a little bit different to the ones we've seen previously, and that's because it's been put here specifically for marine life. So this is a coral restoration structure, and it's basically a structure for corals and sponges to cling onto. And in turn, this attracts a whole host of marine life. And I've just seen something very interesting just here.
This is an ornate ghost pipefish, a relative of the seahorse. These ghost pipefish can usually be found hiding amongst frilly feather stars, but coral restoration structures are a great second option, providing camouflage, protection, and lots of food. But given these mucky slopes are 99% sand, structures like this are a magnet for a whole host of sea creatures, both big and small. The sponge-encrusted surfaces are covered in small corals that provide shelter for ghost gobies, scorpionfishes, and hawkfishes. And the big empty cavities within the coral structures provide refuge for a whole host of larger reef fish, like big porcupinefishes, puffers, batfish, and trumpetfish, as well as schools of butterfly fish, damsels, and cardinal fish. Although there is no such thing as a safe place on the reef, and these restoration structures are no exception.
Guys, although I didn't find the stonefish under the rice bag earlier, I've just found his bigger brother. Check out this massive stonefish right here.
So this individual is actually a slightly different species, the reef stonefish. But the more deadly estuarine stonefish also hunts within these coral structures, and some of them are nearly impossible to spot.
Look at this one, he's completely buried under the sand. That makes me nervous, I hope I don't land on one.
But although the coral structures, tires, and mooring blocks play their part, There is one bit of trash on this reef that is a true trash hotel. But to see it, we need to go much deeper. And to observe the most interesting creatures, we need to dive it at night.
So, I've just found perhaps the biggest bit of trash on the ocean floor. This is an absolutely enormous boat wreck. And these boat wrecks are home to a whole host of different creatures, so let's have a swim round and see what we can find. Whoa, look at the size of that moray!
And there was more than one.
Whoa!
Moray eels are normally found hiding and hunting within rocky reefs, but the interconnected chambers within this wreck are a perfect alternative. These morays are honeycomb or leopard morays, and like all moray eels, they are voracious nocturnal predators. It's possible that they've just returned to the wreck after a successful hunt. Now, whilst honeycomb morays aren't the biggest species that patrol these reefs, this one is absolutely enormous and is probably nearly 2 meters long. So like the structures in the shallows, this wreck is also encrusted in sponges and corals that in turn attracts many critters that either hunt on it or hide in it. Small diurnal tobies tuck themselves tight against the wreck to avoid detection. And other larger reef fish like damsels, butterflies, and surgeonfish sit motionless in the best hiding spots. Nocturnal predators like tiger cowries and urchins emerge from cover for a night of feeding, as do more charismatic nocturnal critters like this dwarf cuttlefish that was slowly patrolling the sponge-covered hull, looking for crabs to feed on. But the busiest spot is on the roof.
So we're just on the roof now, and it's absolutely covered in fish. Got cardinals and butterfly fish and trumpet fish. Oh, and sweet lips just here.
However, much less common reef fish can also be found here. And this wreck is home to perhaps one of the strangest looking fish in the ocean.
So this here is the large-nosed boxfish. And it doesn't take a genius to work out where it gets its name from. And this one's very friendly look, going up towards the light.
Now, like all boxfish, these large-nosed boxfish have a hard bony carapace instead of scales, making them very difficult to bite. Not that I'm planning on doing that, of course. And if you manage to get hold of one, they'll release a toxin called ostracytoxin that will literally kill everything in the immediate area. It's a good job they've got such a well-developed defense system, because they are terrible swimmers.
Right, let's head inside and see what we can find in here.
And it turns out, we were about to witness one of the most remarkable examples of marine life making the most of ocean trash.
Wow, this is crazy! The wildlife has just completely taken over this place. You can see that all the seats are just covered in sponges and algae and all sorts. And there's all sorts of small little critters around. We've got fish up here, lobsters crawling around all over the floor. And this is a great example of how when big boat wrecks like this stay on the ocean floor for a decent amount of time, they just get completely covered in life. And there are creatures using every surface and every cavity. Even the ceiling's covered in stuff. Come and have a look at this. This has got to be one of the best uses of wildlife using human trash I've ever seen. This is so cool.
Tucked away inside this electrical box is a group of banded pipefish that are almost invisible amongst the mass of entangled wires. This one appears to have developed a more red coloration, perhaps to improve his camouflage further. However, other reef fish are also trying to blend in, but I'm not sure they're the right shape. But there's one encounter that perfectly captures how marine life is making the most of ocean trash. And as we made our way back towards the surface, something caught my eye.
Oh, there's a Coke bottle. Is there anything inside? Oh, there is! There's a coconut octopus! Oh my word, a coconut octopus inside a Coke bottle! There he is, he's just there! These guys, as their name suggests, typically use coconuts or shells for protection, but a plastic or glass bottle will also do perfectly. So he's very happy.
Now, the title of this video is obviously tongue-in-cheek. We all know that removing trash from the ocean, and preventing more from getting into it, is crucial. But the aim of this video was to highlight the remarkable ways that marine life has adapted to a reef littered with debris. And as it turns out, some critters, like this coconut octopus, might like it a little bit too much.
So, I really want to take this Coke bottle out because it says recycle on it, but the little coconut octopus, he won't leave.
Guys, thank you so much for watching. If you're new here, make sure to hit that subscribe button. And if you want to see what other crazy critters patrol this reef at night, go and check out this video.
There he goes, he's free!